a mecca. God is going to show it.
God is going to show.
He's standing right by. We want to say that one more time for somebody who may be discouraged. Don't be a stammer. Because joy is on the way. We can may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Know that God is now. Stand still. Knowing that God is going to show up.
God is going to show.
He is standing right back.
He is standing back.
For those of you who may not know it, there's healing.
There's healing for your sorrow.
There's healing for your pain.
Healing for your pain.
Healing for your spirit.
Healing for your spirit.
There's shelter from the rain.
There's shelter from the rain.
Lord, send the healing.
Lord, send the healing.
Lord, send it for this one day we to heal the sick, sick
soul.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So thank the world.
God bless everyone. Thank you for joining this evening. We see people are slowly coming in, and we say hello to all on the phone. God bless you. This is the day the Lord has made. This is Holy Week, and we thank God for Jesus for today. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and start off with prayer, and then we're going to go ahead and get into our Bible study. Amen. Gracious Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you, dear God. We thank you for today. We thank you, oh God, for waking us up this morning. We thank you, oh God, for starting us and clothing us in our right mind. And God, we pray that you will bless now this Bible study as we go into the Word of God. God, be with us as we study, as we get an understanding of what you'd have us to know. God, we love you and we bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. All right. Let us go to the gospel. We're picking up, and thank you all for the understanding of last week. We're picking up where we left off. As soon as I can get to my book here. Let us go to the gospel according to St. Matthew. Matthew, the 16th chapter. Amen. Matthew, the 16th chapter. And we want to look at Matthew 16. And we want to start reading at the 13th verse. Amen. Matthew 16, 13th verse. It says, "And when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?' And they said, 'Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets.' He saith unto them, 'But whom say ye that I am?' And Simon Peter answered and said, 'Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God.' And Jesus answered and said unto him, 'Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ." All right. So we want to pick up in the middle of page 62, in which it says Jesus and Peter was responding to God's initiative in his life. Jesus asked the disciples who people said he was. Then he asked them who they thought he was. Peter correctly answered, "You are the Christ." Then Jesus made a profound statement to Peter. "This was not revealed to you by man, but my Father in heaven." Why do you all think that Peter was able to identify, or Peter spoke up and said who Jesus was?
Repeat that. I had folks interrupting me.
Why do you all think Peter spoke up and said who Jesus was? Or why was it Peter that confessed who Jesus the Christ is?
He was always speaking up, but also Jesus told him that the Lord told him that.
Right, right. The author says, in essence, Jesus said, "Peter, you could not have known and confessed that I am the Christ unless my Father had been at work in your life. He caused you to know who I am. You are responding to the Father's activity in your life." And then the author says, "Do you realize God determined to love you? Apart from that, you never would have become a Christian. He had something in mind when he called you. He began to work in your life. You experienced a love relationship with God when he took the initiative. He opened your understanding. He drew you to himself." The interesting thing about the scripture we just read is that Jesus makes it a point to, he makes a teaching opportunity for all the disciples, for them to realize that it was not man that gave this impression, but God. One can actually say that our true relationship, whoa, hope y'all didn't see that. I'm sorry. I can't believe that just happened. The true relationship, I'm just dropping the Bible all over the place. The true relationship, that's when the, you know, happens when you see certain people on there. Hey, whoa, I can't hear. Anyway.
Don't blame it on me. Don't blame it on me.
She's been on there for a while.
Thank you, Sister Marianne. That ain't right. My fault.
That's right, Stacy. Don't take the blame. Don't take the blame.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Stacy sitting there cool as a cucumber, and you're the one fumbling and carried on.
Oh, boy. Okay, back to the word. Notice that Jesus makes it a point to get them to realize that God is involved in the reveal of who he is. Mm-hmm. That's what I love about this scripture. Mm-hmm. And this is a lesson for all of us, mm-hmm. that our relationship develops the closer we get to God, the closer that we realize that God is an intricate part of our life, strengthens our relationship with him. Mm-hmm. And Jesus makes it a point for them to know that only God can reveal who he is, not man, not woman, and they could not be amongst the people to have the reveal given unto them. In other words, they are not suckered in to what man is saying, but they are led by what God has revealed unto them. And that's true of us today. Okay, that's true of us, that in order to grow closer to him, we gravitate more towards what we believe about him. We gravitate to the Lord actively working in our life. And all of this is intentional by God. When God calls us, when God speaks to us, when God wants for us to grow more sincere and serious about our walk with him, God will draw himself closer to us, and we draw ourselves closer to him. Mm-hmm. Not based on what other folks say, not based on what grandma taught us, not based on what we were taught to do as children, but what we come to know about God ourselves. All right, let's look at here. It says, what did you do when God took the initiative? So let me ask y'all that question. This is a very good question. When God took the initiative in your life, when you realized that God was calling you or pulling you or speaking to you, how did you respond? Would anybody like to be so candid or to reveal how your response was to God once you were touched by God? Mm-hmm. Some people respond, some folks reject it. Some folks go right away, some people it takes them time. In the example we just read of the scripture, notice that the scripture starts off by some of the other disciples being a little bit timid about who Jesus was. But Peter was very bold, as somebody already said, as he always is, he could stand on who Jesus was. He was not timid. And the reason I'm pointing this out is because our response to God is not always immediate. It's not always receptive. It's not always, we're in Matthew chapter 16, Reverend Mike, we just read 13 through through 17. Matthew chapter 16, we just read 13 through 17. Our response to the call of God or how God revealed in our life is not always immediate. It's not always accepting. It's not always fuzzy-dubby either. We respond to God differently. But the awesome thing about God is that ultimately the way we are drawn to him is when we truly identify that is him. That's why Jesus said, Jesus makes it a point to tell Peter, flesh didn't reveal it to you, but God did. And when we authentically receive from the Lord and know it's God, that's what convicts our heart to grow our relationship closer and thicker and stronger with who he is. All right? The author says, when you responded to his invitation, he brought you into a love relationship with himself. You would never know that love, be in the presence of that love, or experience that love if God had not first reached out to you. Think about your own lives. Think about your own experience with God. You would never be a Christ follower, a Christian, if God had not touched you, if you had not accepted the invitation when God touched you. God can touch you all day long, but it does not mean that you receive it. It's after we receive it, the touch from him, the invitation, that we begin to follow him. Any questions, comments on that, observations? All right. Let's look at item six. Item six says, did anybody do this exercise? Number the following items from 1 to 4 in the order they occur in the development of a love relationship with God. Does anyone do that?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead, Sister Jean. What did you come up with?
Unmute, Jean.
Oh, go ahead, Sister Jean. Tell us what you came up with.
Okay. I had 4.
Right.
B, 3. C, 2. And D, 1.
Right. So, first of all, the way the author points out our relationship with God is developed is in the following way. First, God chooses us because he loves us.
Mm-hmm.
Second, God show me his love and reveals him to me.
Mm-hmm.
Thirdly, I respond to God's activity in my life and invite him to do in my life what he pleases. And lastly, God comes into my life and fellowships with me. Now, the interesting thing about this is it sounds like we're doing a lot of the work, but it's really God. It sounds like it's us drawing God in, but it's us drawing ourselves closer to him. Because first of all, if you are not cognizant or recognizing who the Lord is, you can't follow God. You cannot follow him. And that is the point that Jesus makes to Peter. Only God can give the reveal of who Jesus in fact was. And it is because he did that Jesus gives him the inheritance of the church because of his acceptance. All right. Any questions, comments on that? All right. Let's talk about some of these scriptures that are outlined here. Let's talk about Luke 10 and 22. And what they want you to do is summarize how God acts what he does to take the initiative. Luke, the 10th chapter, the 22nd verse says, all things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows who the Son is except the Father. And no one knows who the Father is except the Son. and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him, okay? How does God act and what does he do to take an initiative in that verse? What is the initiative taken in that verse? Anybody?
He's revealing who he is.
That's right. That's absolutely right. God takes the initiative to reveal who he is to us. Okay, I'm gonna do one or two more and then I'm gonna come back to that, okay? Philippians 2 and 13, it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. I'll say that again, Philippians 2 and 13. It is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. What is God, how is God taking the initiative in that verse?
He motivates dedicated service
to God. Yes, yes, yes. So he's exposing his will. He's exposing what his will is. And you know what? I want to pause right there and explain that the more that we seek his will, the more we come closer to him. Because as God's will, the point of that scripture is Paul is telling the Philippian church to be open to seek what God's will is for your life. Mm-hmm. The more that we seek God's will for us, the more that we draw ourselves closer to God. Okay? And we're going to do one more, and then we're going to come back to some of that. Revelations 3 and 20 says, here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Okay, what is God doing to take the initiative in that scripture?
He's inducing sinners to repent and turn to him.
Yes, yes, he's knocking. He's exposing the situation. And so to summarize all of this, these scriptures demonstrate to us that God is all around us. His will, his ways, his presence, all of this is in front of us daily. It is up to us to discover who it is. God has already taken the initiative. God has already extended the hand of invitation. God has already given us the reveal. It's up to us to seek it for ourselves. Questions, comments on that? Observations? All right. The summary says God always takes the initiative in this love relationship. I do not choose him. He chooses me, loves me, and reveals his eternal purposes for my life. I cannot know God's activity unless he takes the initiative to reveal it to me. Sometimes we must know, that God, in fact, loves us. That might sound silly, but the most basic definition of God's love for us is often missed. The Bible says in one of the most famous scriptures that we've known since we was a child, God so loved the world that he gave. That alone is an initiative of action. Mm-hmm. Because he loved us, he gave his only begotten son. Mm-hmm. All right? God takes the initiative. God extends the hand. God knocks. He says, I will knock and the door shall be open. Seek, and ye shall find. Y'all know that scripture? All right? Mm-hmm. Seek and ye shall find. So in other words, what that tells us is that he's already existing. It's up to us to make the effort towards him. to seek him. If we seek him for ourselves, we will find, we will discover his love for us. Any questions, comments on that? Observations?
And that's a good point, Pastor, that you're bringing up there about that. But one thing we have to be cognizant of too is that when God is knocking, we have to ask ourselves the question, is our hearts open to receive?
Yes,
because
yes,
just like
yes,
you said, yes. Just like you said, other brother pastor, God can be speaking to you, but if you got a closed heart, you won't hear anything he says. It'll just go right on through, just like blow through the wind. But when you're trying to connect with God and he's trying to connect with you, he wants your heart to be open to receive him, so that way you can know that it is God's voice and it's not outside voices that are speaking to you.
Amen. That's so good. Example of that I like to bring up is Doubting Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible tells us that they had all already told Thomas what they saw. They saw Jesus or whatever, but Thomas is still doubting. He said, I got to see for myself.
Right.
But it could be that Thomas was not open to what had already pre-existed.
Yes.
If he was not open to it, then he was not as apt to receive.
Absolutely. Amen. Okay.
And you know what? Thank you, Holy Ghost. That's the same way with church. Sometimes we sit in church and we look at the preacher and we say, oh, he doing wrong already. He dressing silly. He's sleeping with all these women. I ain't listening to nothing he got to say. But in the end, what we must realize is that we can't allow flesh to tune us out
for what
God wants us to receive.
Absolutely. Amen.
All right. Now, all I'm saying is that God placed you in a position to hear his word.
Right.
How he uses that vessel is between God and the vessel.
That's right.
But it's up to you to be willing and open
to
receive it.
That's it.
Okay. That's it. We have to be able to move beyond flesh and be ready to receive what the Spirit wants us to
do. Amen. Amen.
Sometimes flesh gets in the way of us receiving what God wants us to receive. And that's why that goes back to how we started tonight. That goes back to the fact that Jesus told Peter, you're going to be blessed because flesh did not reveal this. Man did not reveal this to
you.
But God did. And because the Spirit led you to the Lord, you will be blessed with the keys to the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
And that's what I like to say, y'all. We got to be apt to want to look for, search, receive what the Spirit wants us to receive.
Right.
Not man, not woman, not our bank account, not our jobs, not our children. We have got to be open to what does God want me to have.
Right.
Any other questions, comments on that? Observation. All right. I really have been waiting to get to this part tonight. This is a very real lesson here, what we're about to discuss. Okay. So now we're talking about a very real and personal relationship with God, a practical relationship with him. I'm on page 64. The author starts out by saying God's plan for the advancement of his kingdom depends on his relationship with his people, all right? And then it says, the relationship God wants to have with you will be real and personal. Some people ask, can a person actually have a real and personal and practical relationship with God? They seem to think God is far off and unconcerned about their day-to-day living. That is not the God we see in the scriptures. Now, they give us a list of scriptures here, and they want us to describe at least one fact indicating the relationship the person had with God. And the first example they give us is Adam and Eve after they sinned, coming from Genesis 3:20-21. And the example gives us they were naked. God made garments of skin for them. All right. Let's move to some of these. I'm not going to do all these. I just really want to do a few of them. Let's look at 12 Jesus D. 12 Jesus sent out to preach. See Mark 7 through 13. Let's look at Mark, the gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 6. The gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 6. And we want to look at verse 7, okay? The gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 6, verse 7 through 13. Mark, chapter 6, verse 7 through 13. It says, and he called unto him the 12 and began to send them forth by two and two and gave them power over unclean spirits and commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey, save a staff, only no scrip, no bread, no money in their purse. But be shod with sandals and not put on two coats. And he said unto them, in one place, soever ye enter into an house, there abide till ye depart from that place. And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear you when ye depart thence, shake off the dust under your feet for a testimony against them. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. And they went out and preached that men should repent, and they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them. All right? So with this, what is one fact that indicated the relationship the person had with God was real, personal, and practical in that example? Anybody?
He gave them power over unclean spirits.
Right, right. Anybody else? The other thing too is he almost tells them, I got your back. Mm-hmm. Okay? Because he says that if you go to somebody's crib and they don't want to hear nothing you got to say, shake the dust off your feet and go to the next person.
That's right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. That tells me that God is saying that I'm with you. Mm-hmm. That I'm very real, I'm practical, I stand with you, I walk with you, even when you go to a place of rejection. And as Gene is alluding to, not only is he saying he will stand with them, but he will give them power.
Power.
He will give them power, even in a place of rejection. Oh my God, I just said something right there. The Lord is so real with you that even in a place where others won't receive you, he says, I will still give you power. Oh my God, today. That will preach. That will preach. Because oftentimes we can't be in a place of reject. We can't be in a rejective place, especially if we think we're by ourselves. Mm-hmm. But our relationship should be so real with God that we know God got our back. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right? Let's go to one more of these. Peter in prison awaiting trial. And I just want to read some of this. Acts, the 12th chapter. Let's look at Acts, the 12th chapter. The Acts of the Apostles, the 12th chapter. And I'm only going to read some of the 1 through 17, okay? Acts, the 12th chapter, and I'm going to read starting at the third verse. And it says, and because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread, and when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. All right? So I really want to make this clear, okay? Because as Peter, as Peter's locked up, there's some people praying for him.
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to come back to that for a minute. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door keep the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise up quickly," and his chains fell off from his hands. Mm-hmm. I want to go down to verse 11. And when Peter was come to himself, he said, "Now I know of a surety." Woo! Woo, that's my shouting point in the sermon right there. He said, "Now I know with a surety that the Lord have sent his angel and have delivered me out of the hand of Herod from all the expectation of the Jews." And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. Okay? Now, what is the very real relationship and practical relationship here with Peter? Anybody?
That Jesus delivered him.
Yes. Thank you, Gloria. Mm-hmm. And not only that, Peter was so close to that. The Bible shows us that people, even though, y'all got to know, Peter didn't even know that the people was praying for him.
No.
But because he was close to God, the Bible says that he had the surety.
Yes.
He was sure that it was God that brought him out. Mm-hmm. Yes. Amen. Thank you, Lord, today.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because he knew that he was close to the Lord. Oh, y'all, I love this scripture. Because he knew that he was that close to God, the Bible said he had confidence. He was sure that it was God that brought him, that released him. All right? Why are you expressing this? Why are you expressing this tonight, brother pastor? Because this is the type of very real and practical sense of belief relationship that we should have with the Lord.
Yes.
We should be so confident. Thank you, God, today, that God is on our side, that God hears our prayers, that God looks out for us, that God has our back in the front and in the side, and that somewhere, somehow, somebody is praying for us. Somebody has faith with us. And all of those prayers that our grandmama and our great-grandmama and our great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandmama and them said, generation after generation, falls upon who we are today. We have to have a very real, personable relationship with God, that we know this for ourselves, that beyond a shadow of a doubt, we know that the Lord is on our side.
Yes.
And that's what the author is saying here tonight. Okay. Now, I'm going to get back to the book because it says some very good stuff here in the book. The book says the disciples also had a real personal and practical relationship with Jesus. The Son of God, Jesus had chosen them to be with him. What a joy it must have been to have such an intimate relationship with Jesus. When Jesus gave them a difficult assignment, he did not send them out helpless. He mm-hmm. gave them authority, that's the power, mm-hmm. they had never known before evil spirits. In some places of the world, obedience to the Lord results in imprisonment. This was Peter's experience. In answer to prayer, the Lord miraculously delivered him. Mm-hmm. This was so dramatic. Peter first thought it was a dream. The praying Christians thought he was an angel. Mm-hmm. Soon, they discovered the Lord's deliverance was real. That deliverance probably saved Peter's life. All right? Mm-hmm. Now, the author ends all of this by saying, your life can also reflect a real, personal, and practical relationship as you respond to God's work in your life, okay? What do you all think about being real and practical with God? What does that mean to you, anybody?
being, and to me, being real and practical mean you can talk to him about anything.
Amen.
Know that he has, that he, if he's going to be a yes, no, or maybe so.
Mm-hmm.
So, you shouldn't have any fears when you come to talk to him and say, well, I can't talk to the Lord about this, but you can talk to him about anything.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else? I love the author says, God's constant presence is the most practical part of your life and ministry. Okay.
Yes.
So with God constantly at work in our lives, it's the most practical. It's the most useful. It's mm-hmm. the most purposeful thing that we have that's our goings on in our life on a daily basis. But we must realize that for ourselves, y'all. We must realize that God is constantly at work.
Yes.
Even when we don't, Peter, you got to know that I'm sorry, my niece just threw me off. Peter, may not have known that people was praying, but certainly he had faith that they were, that somebody was, that the Lord was moving. That's really what I really want to say. He had faith that God was still moving. And to have faith that God is at work is the practicality of being a Christian or a Christ follower. Mm-hmm. All right? Now, the author says also, love must be real and personal. A person cannot love without someone to love. A love relationship with God takes place between two persons. A relationship with God is real and personal. This has always been his desire. His efforts are expended to bring this desire to reality. God is a person pouring his life into yours. Christianity is a personal, practical, progressive relationship with Almighty God. If for some reason you cannot think of a time when your relationship with God was real, personal, and practical, spend time evaluating your relationship with him, okay? So the author is saying here that we must come to realize God is a very personable God. Just like our very best friend, but even more than that, just like our moms, our dads, those people that are very intimate in our lives, we should have a very real intimacy with God in the same way. Comments, questions on that?
Going back to something else, Brother Pastor, you talked about when we was talking about Peter and how the members at home were praying for him. It just rung to me how powerful the church can be when the church comes together and pray for someone else.
Right.
Because that can be the difference of just getting somebody delivered, somebody set free. When we come together corporately and pray, that we know that there's power in prayer.
Amen. Amen.
And it has changed. And sometimes that person, like that's you said, right, may not know who's praying for them. But when we come together collectively, it just opens up the windows of heaven. Then God has to react. When we act, he has to react. Come together to pray for somebody else, that may be the difference of setting somebody free or bringing somebody even closer to Christ.
That's right. That's right.
When we pray. So you got to realize that there's powerful when we pray together corporately.
That's right. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Yeah. One thing I love about our church is I know you all are praying. When we say that we're praying, I know y'all praying, and I appreciate that, you know, with the prayer list, with the, you know, different opportunities we have for prayer. You know, prayer is just so important. And just a quick plug, we are doing a prayer service on Thursday night. I'm gonna say more of that before the end of the night, but you know, prayer is essential. Prayer is essential. I really wanna get to what the author says here too. The author says, God's constant presence is the most practical part of your life and ministry. Unfortunately, we often assign God a limited role in our lives. Then we call on him whenever we need help. This is the exact opposite of what we find in God's word. He is the one who is working in our world. He invites you to relate to him so he will accomplish his work through you. His plan for the advancement of the kingdom depends on his working in real and practical ways through his relationships with his people. Knowing and experiencing God through a real and personal relationship was practical in the scriptures. Be patient as we work together. I believe you will find that this kind of walk with God will be exceedingly helpful to you. So I really want to express that all of us should look at our relationship with God, or where we stand even in our relationship with God. How often do we include God during the course of the day? How often do we notice when God is at work around us? How often do we utilize or pay attention to the voice of God, or even the direction as we're led by God? I really want to go back to the very first thing we read tonight, all right? Peter had to have a certain, Jesus points out to Peter, that you had to have a certain relationship, mm-hmm. certain view, a certain touch, a certain cognition or understanding of who he was in order for it to be revealed who Jesus was. Jesus makes it a point in that scripture to point that out with the simpleness of saying, flesh did not reveal it unto you. In other words, he's telling Peter, you're at a certain, you're at a different level from everybody else. Everybody else said, I'm a prophet. Everybody else said, I'm a teacher. Everybody else said, I'm this and that. But you're out from amongst other people. And y'all, as believers, as Christians, we got to be out from amongst other folk that don't know who God is. Be not of this world. Romans 12, 1 through 2. All right? We are peculiar people, okay? And so even with the disciples, you got to remember, the disciples, as we read earlier tonight, are growing with their relationship with Jesus, even as they travel with him, as they do ministry with him. All right? So I'm pointing all that out to say is that we have to look at our own relationship, our own, how do we relate God in our lives? How do we include God in our lives? Questions, comments on that, observations?
You're right.
Okay, we actually are going to stop there. We're going to pick up on page 70 on next week. Just a quick announcement. On Thursday, it's Holy Week. Praise God for the sacrifice that Jesus gave to us. It's Holy Week, and on Thursday, we are going to have a prayer service. I'm encouraging everyone to pass along our phone conference number and join us on Facebook. There will be a group of ministers on Facebook that will be praying at the 7 o'clock hour, Pacific Standard Time. And we want all of you all to send in your prayer requests, things that you seek the Lord for. We really want to go to the Lord in prayer on Thursday night for Holy Week. Amen. And thank God for each of you. If all minds are clear, we're going to turn to the Lord in prayer at this time. We ask to have all eyes closed and every head bowed. Gracious Father God, we thank you tonight. We thank you, dear God, for bringing us together again. We thank you for your word, God. We thank you, oh God, for the relationship, the who you are to each of us in our lives. God, I pray, God, for the church. I pray for every church that's opened up in your name. I pray for every believer. I pray for everybody that has maybe given up, oh God, maybe given up on God, on who you are in their lives. Maybe are lacking faith and need strength. Somebody lacks faith tonight and needs strength, oh God. I feel it in my spirit. And God, we pray for them. God, we pray for a mighty move of you in somebody's lives tonight. God, we pray for the one that's on sick bed, oh God, that's in a hospital room. that's in a rehab facility, nursing home, behind prison walls tonight, oh God, that may be in the sick and shut in, Lord, may not have food to eat. God, we give them unto you, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. I pray for every mother, oh God, every father, every grandmother, every grandfather, every great-grandmother. I pray, God, for the elderly tonight. God, I come praying for families tonight. I come pray for every household, oh God, that's represented in this circle right now. God, I lift up every home. I pray that the angels will encamp themselves to every household that's witnessing this prayer right now in the name of Jesus. Somebody needs a move tonight, Lord. Somebody needs healing tonight. Somebody needs a blessing tonight. Somebody needs a miracle tonight, oh God. Somebody needs healing. Somebody needs deliverance, oh God. Somebody needs a touch from you tonight. God, we come here praying right now in the name of Jesus. We pray for restoration. We pray, oh God, for blessedness, bless souls tonight, oh God. God, I lift up every bereaved family that stand at a loss tonight. They may have lost a loved one, oh God. God, I give every bereaved family unto you right now in the name of Jesus. Somebody stand in the need of prayer, oh God. I don't know who it is, but it's in my spirit that somebody standing strong in need of prayer, that's looking for your face. God, reveal your face tonight. Reveal your hand on tonight, oh God. Reveal your touch on tonight, oh God. Somebody may be abused. Somebody may be physically abused, psychologically tormented, oh God. We give them to you, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. God, I come here praying for every young woman, every young man that's standing in need of prayer. God, I pray for our children, oh God. I pray, oh God, for our children near and far, oh God. Everybody that's traveling right now, God, need traveling grace. God, I come here praying for each and every person on the sick list, Lord, right now, on the prayer list. God, we give our prayer list unto you, God, you would give healing to every name that's on that prayer list, Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus. God, I come here praying for Reverend Michael tonight, God, that you would continue to heal him in the name of Jesus. Heal his voice. Heal his voice box, oh God, his throat, oh God. Bless him on tonight, oh God. Bless every minister that stand flat-footed and preaching the gospel. God, bless every pastor, oh God. Oh God, bless every man and woman of God, oh God, that stand in John's shoes tonight. God, I come here praying for your church, oh God, praying for every church that's amongst those believers that need a word. Somebody need a word. Somebody need prayer tonight. Yes. And God, we give them unto you, Lord, right now. In the name of Jesus, God, we love you. Oh, God, thank you for your sacrifice, for the blood, for your son, for the sacrificial lamb, God. God, we weren't worthy, oh, God, but you blessed us. You gave us a second chance, God. Thank you for that. Lord, we're not worthy. We're just dust of the ground. So God, you blessed us, oh, God, thank you. Thank you for blessing us, oh, God. Thank you, God, for forgiving us. Lord, we ask for forgiveness of all of our sins, Lord. Lord, all those things that we've done that were unlike you, God, forgive us on tonight. God, forgive us and have mercy upon us, oh God. Oh God, we thank you on tonight. God, you're so worthy. God, you're so worthy to be praised. We praise you on tonight, God. We love you, oh God. We love you,
bless your name right
now. Oh God, I pray for every person, oh God, that has a loved one that's thinking about them on their mind and heart. Even as I say this prayer, God, I give that person to you, Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, God. I pray, oh God, for those that don't know who you are, for those the lost souls that don't know Jesus, oh God, the ones that are outdoors, the ones that are strung out on drugs and alcohol, God. God, I give them to you, Lord, tonight, in the name of Jesus, oh God. Somebody's standing in need of prayer. Somebody's standing in need of a word. Somebody's standing in need of deliverance. Somebody's in need of healing. Somebody stand in need of a blessing, oh God.
And we come here praying, Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, thank you for your son. Thank you for the blood of the Lamb, oh God. Thank you, oh God, for healings. Thank you for miracles. Thank you for blessings, oh God. Oh God, you're so worthy to be praised. And we thank you tonight. We thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless all of you. Amen. We will see you next time. Amen. God bless you tonight.
Bless. All right.